therefore agree to invite all candidates who represent a party with an MP or a local councillor. We set this criteria prior to the change in UKIP's representation, but felt it would be inappropriate to uninvite that candidate. Therefore, you have five candidates appearing tonight who will be introduced to you shortly. In addition, there are two other declared candidates, these being Stephen Morris of the English Democrats and Marcus Farmer, an independent. We shall reiterate the names of all seven declared candidates at the conclusion of tonight's hustings. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Johnny. Good evening. Thank you all for coming here tonight. It's a pleasure to welcome you here today. My name is Nathan Broder. I'm the head boy at King David High School. Let me begin by thanking King David High School and Joshua Rowe for letting us use their amazing facilities tonight. Equally, can I extend my thanks to Simon and all the team at the Jewish Leadership Council for helping to coordinate this event, in particular to Mark Levy, JLC's Northwest Manager, who I'm sure don't agree is a fantastic advocate for the Jewish community. I'd also like to thank the Jewish Rep Council for their input into tonight's event. It's a shame that the Rep Council President, Sharon Bannister, can't be with us tonight. She's away on presidential duties, supervising the construction of a wall. Now let's move on to the five people who've made tonight's event possible. The five candidates from Mayoral Greater Manchester. In alphabetical order, Sean Anstee, the Conservative candidate, councillor for Burnham Ward, and has served as leader of the Trafford Council for the past 3 years, at 29. He's the youngest council leader in the country. He recently launched his mayoral campaign alongside a member of parliament for Tasson, George Osborne, and it's clear that Sean aims to follow in his footsteps. So we look forward to Sean being announced as the editor of the Manchester Evening News. Next, we have Jane Brophy, the Liberal Democrat candidate, and another Trafford councillor, this time for Timperley. Jane was the party's candidate in the 2015 Oldham by-election. She's been campaigning vigorously across Greater Manchester, leafleting, kissing babies, shaking everyone's hand. Well, almost everyone. The Labour candidate, Andy Burnham, has been a Member of Parliament for Leeds since 2001. He served as Gordon Brown's Secretary of State for Health, although I'm sure for most of the time he was looking after Gordon Brown's health. He was also a Culture Secretary in the last Labour government and a served in Shadow Cabinet as Shadow Education, Shadow Health and Shadow Home Secretary. Andy has stood twice for the leadership of the Labour Party, first in 2010, when everybody thought that the winning candidate would either be called Ed or Miliband, and again in 2015 when nobody thought the winning candidate would be called Jeremy or Corbyn. So Andy's right, literally, is Schneur Odze, the UKIP candidate. Schneur was fourth on UKIP's Northwest Regional list for the European Parliament elections in 2014 and currently serves as chair of Friends of Israel and UKIP, or two of them. Although a strong UKIP for today, Schneur is a former Conservative councillor in Hackney. As the old saying goes, you can take a boy out of Sanford Hill, but it'll only come and move to Portland Park. Unlike those who are standing against, Schneur is the only candidate whose first name rhymes with the office he's wishing to seek, which is why he went for the very catchy campaign slogan, Odds for Men. Finally, we have Will Patterson, the Green Party candidate. Will is the current chair of the Wigan and Lee Green Party, and if elected, Will promises to push all 10 councils in Greater Manchester to introduce a presumption against fracking applications. Labour Bury Council has banned fracking on all council land, and some in the local Green Party have said that this is their idea and not Labour's, but surely they have no problem with recycling. That makes all the candidates, unless Johnny Weinberg decides to stand as the independent anti-Gary Neville candidate. And if that's all, I'll pass you on to the very capable hands of our chair, Simon Johnson, and a distinguished guest. Simon has served as a solicitor for ITV, worked at the Premier League and again for the English FA, where he helped Russia to secure the 2018 World Cup bid. Now the chief executive for the Jewish Leadership Council, Simon has gone from football to community service, a bit like Jeremy Barton.
don't have any jokes, and I will invite the candidates to tell me afterwards whether that is the most fun they've had in an introduction or the least, depending on how it goes. And that has set the bar now. I've said to Andy, and I'll repeat to everybody, you'll be judged on the number of jokes that you make. Let me just run through the rules of this evening. We're going to run it as tightly as we can. Each candidate will be invited to deliver an opening statement. That opening statement will be a maximum of 4 minutes. And we will work in alphabetical order, starting with Sean Anstee until we and through to Will Patterson. After that, I will invite questions from the floor. All questions have now been submitted, so I will ask somebody to ask their question. Please wait for the microphone to come to you. Ask your question, and then each candidate will be given 2 minutes to answer that particular question, or up to 2 minutes. At the end, when every candidate has answered, each of the other candidates will be able to come back for a maximum of 1 minute. Then at the end, each candidate will be able to give a closing speech of a maximum of 2 minutes. Don't worry if you're confused by that or bored by it. I've got it all written down, so I will remember what's going on. And so what I ask you to do is please, we are, one of the things that we pride ourselves on in the Jewish community is respecting all of our guests, and all of the candidates are our guests here tonight, so please show them the utmost respect as they seek this important office and these hustings go ahead. So, for the first of the opening statements, I'd like to invite Conservative Party candidate Sean Anstee.
Thank you very much indeed for, I think, what is the funniest introduction that we've seen so far, and it sets the tone, hopefully, for what is going to be a very interesting debate for us this evening. I would certainly not mind being the editor of Manchester Evening News for the next 30-odd days, if not to get some decent stories from them about the campaign that we're doing. I think what I wanted to start by saying is that I'm in this race to try and win it. I want us to be able to make the most of the opportunity that's coming to Greater Manchester in May to ensure that we have a mayoralty that really means something to the people and businesses of this city region. Because I think we're a place that's on the verge of something very special. And the Jewish community here in Greater Manchester has a huge role to play, both in our future, but also has made a huge contribution to the rich tapestry of this city region in all of the places of it. And we should be making sure that as we have a mayoralty, that as we move forward with taking decisions over the things that affect our lives, that we're no longer just talking about these things, we can do something about them in May in a way that we've not been able to do before, that we can have such a profoundly positive impact on the lives and businesses here in Greater Manchester. So I want us to be a place where we can celebrate the diversity of this city region, but also champion our togetherness as one place and one city region where we're respectful, where we're tolerant, where we're able to ensure that everybody is able to realise their potential. And I think about, as we take that opportunity, the powers over health and social care, over policing, over housing, over planning, all of these different things that are coming to us in May mean that we can do something very different in Greater Manchester. It means that we can do something for the first time. We can move our city region forward in a way that we've been able to in the past. So I want to create a global Greater Manchester, one that is attracting inward investment in jobs and skills, that is making sure that we're trading with the rest of the world. I want everybody to feel wealthier. I want every person, every family, every place to be wealthier than what it is today. I want every place and every person to be able to realise their full potential. That's what I want to achieve for Greater Manchester. And specifically in relation to health and social care, I had the opportunity last year to visit the Fed, which is an amazing way of providing care to this community. In fact, it's a model that could be used for other health and social care services in Greater Manchester, where we look after people's well-being. And two specific policies I wanted to share with you in relation to those that I've announced in my manifesto. One is about a police time bank, so that we can, for the first time, communities across Greater Manchester will be able to work with Greater Manchester Police to ensure that we direct resources where they're needed most. And secondly, is in relation to housing. A very clear view on having new homes across Greater Manchester, the right types of homes that are needed, and making sure that we reserve a proportion of those new homes for existing communities. And I know that is important in the manifesto that we shared with me in the run-up to today's hustings. I think it's a Conservative government that is leading the way on making sure that we accept the definition of the International Holocaust Remembrance group around anti-Semitism last year instructed by the ACLG to ensure that no local authority was able to boycott Israeli goods, which is absolutely the right thing to do. And to say that, you know, many people, I think, used to think that the Labour Party represented them. Many people don't think that's the case today, no more so than that can be true for this community here, especially with the leadership of the Labour Party, who pretty much, I think, have abandoned you. And so the final thing I want to say, just in terms of my final contribution, is that this is our moment. This is our moment to do something very different, to do something very special, to say that we can elect somebody who has got us to this point today. I could work with central government, but equally as important with the Labour leaders across Greater Manchester. I've helped write the devolution agreements that we've had over the last few years. I know them inside out. I know what the powers of this mayoralty to be can be. And together we can create a very new, bold Greater Manchester. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the introduction, and very pleased to be here. So I'm standing to be your mayor because I care passionately about Greater Manchester. I grew up here, I went to school here, and I brought up my children here. I love this city, I love its diversity and its history, and the spirit of the city too. And I want our city to be better for everyone. So a little bit about who I am. I've worked in the NHS, in public services, in Greater Manchester all my professional life. I'm a grassroots politician. I'm a local councillor. I've represented my ward in Timperley for almost 17 years. So what I'd like to offer as your Greater Manchester Mayor, I want to offer hope, solution-focused ideas and experience of life, moving away from the same old top-down approaches of the last 30 years. Because Greater Manchester must continue to attract investment, innovation and talent. I think there's a room full of it right here. And we're deeply divided as a country and as a city region. And I think the referendum results of last year made that very clear, and Brexit is continuing to have that effect on people. Greater Manchester's place in the world is best secured, in my view, by being in Europe at its heart and not pushed to the sidelines. And it's through this personal experience I've got as an NHS worker, as a councillor, as a carer, I think there are plenty of shortfalls within our services in Greater Manchester as well. And these problems need real solutions. I don't think we need the same old top-down approaches of the last 30 years. We need a more grassroots approach, and as a Liberal Democrat, that's what I offer. We do have a north-south divide in Greater Manchester, and I think that needs to be addressed. I think we need investment in people, in opportunities and better quality of life for everybody. I think this is best dealt with by securing a strong, local, highly trained workforce. I think some of the top-down skills training we have has failed to prepare everybody. So we need to prepare everybody through education so that everyone's got the opportunity to step forward into a brighter future of prosperity, work and fulfilling employment. I want to ensure Greater Manchester continues as a world-class, outward-looking, international city that welcomes everyone and all the benefits that this can bring. So what we need is a fully integrated transport system within Greater Manchester so that people can get to where they want to go at an affordable price. We need smart ticketing on Greater Manchester for all of our public transport. So a better transport system will allow us to tackle air pollution across our region, and that will lead to a better quality of life. We need to safeguard our green spaces across our borough for the well-being of future generations. And I think we need fresh thinking to tackle climate change and air pollution to ensure our world is safe for our children. So the kind of mayor I want to be open, transparent, welcoming everybody, breaking down those barriers between voters and politicians. I want us here to be a shining beacon of tolerance to the rest of the country and to the world. And I want us to be united in tackling the problems that this city region faces after years of failure and false promises from other politicians. I see this as a big opportunity. We've got health and social care coming together, along with policing, transport, housing and the environment. And it would be better for Greater Manchester because all these areas of policy were working as a whole, working together. So it'd be my job to look at the big picture and keep this vision of integration for our city. I hope my legacy as your mayor will be better outcomes for everybody. So let's all step forward for Greater Manchester. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Jane. So next up is the Labour Party candidate, Andy Byrne.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's quite hard to follow Nathan's introduction, actually. It was excellent. All I can say in response to it is, unlike George Osborne, I only want one job, and that job is to be the first elected mayor of Greater Manchester. This is a massive moment for us. It's our moment in the spotlight. It's the first chance we've ever had to take power out of Westminster and do things for ourselves, to do things differently. That's the Greater Manchester spirit. And it's going to need somebody with leadership, with judgment, with experience. You know, it's going to be a huge challenge. Look at what's happening in the NHS right now. The NHS is part of the devolution deal, under real pressure. Look at the challenge of Brexit. No bigger challenge. Getting that right, making sure that Greater Manchester stays where we want to be, at the head of the game, but also ensuring that we're managing the risks that come from Brexit. And also the wider social challenges. The rising hate crime that we see. This is a very difficult moment, actually. A difficult moment in politics. I would say that this is a cabinet-level job that requires cabinet-level experience. And I am the only candidate in this election who can provide that. I have been Chief Secretary to the Treasury, Culture, Media and Sport Secretary, and Health Secretary in the Cabinet of the last Labour government. And since then, Shadow Education Secretary, Shadow Health Secretary, Shadow Home Secretary. I have a decade of experience at the top of British politics, and I want to put that experience to the service of Greater Manchester, and indeed to the service of you, of your community, because as well as having the experience, I will be a strong voice for your community. In my 16 years in Parliament as a Greater Manchester MP, I have always been a member of Labour Friends of Israel. I visited Israel with LFI in 2004. I've always been a strong supporter of the Holocaust Educational Trust. I visited Auschwitz-Birkenau with them in 2007. I've always been a voice for the community. I will continue to be so if I'm elected as the first mayor of Greater Manchester. I will have a zero tolerance approach to anti-Semitism and ensure that there is no suggestion that it can be treated as a second class form of racism, as some sometimes imply. I will oppose any boycott of Israel, Israeli goods and of Jewish-owned businesses, as we've seen in Manchester in recent times. I will be a strong voice for you, and I'll be a strong voice against my own party. I've already done that in the last year. Challenged the inadequate response to the anti-Semitism that has been there through our recent leadership elections. I will continue to do that because I will be my own man in this role. I will be taking instructions from nobody. I will be first and foremost a voice for Greater Manchester and for you. But as well, I will also look at how we can ensure that public services are there for you, ensuring that there are other school places like this excellent school under Joshua's incredible leadership, making sure that the health service is there. I visited the Fed too, like Sean. It's an incredible model. He's absolutely right to say that. We could see much more of that kind of person-centred provision around Greater Manchester. And I will always, and I promise you this, I will always celebrate the long and incredible contribution of the Jewish community to building Greater Manchester into what it is today. The people that have made that possible, no greater, of course, than Sir Howard Bernstein, who stood down on Friday. But I can also assure you that I will build on the foundations that Sir Howard and others have laid, because in the end, it's not just about experience or being a strong voice with profile on the national stage. It's also about having a vision for Greater Manchester. And I have got a vision for Greater Manchester as the modern industrial capital of the country, a digital city, a green city, a young city. I have put young people at the heart of my manifesto, because I don't believe you can build a prosperous society in the future without giving hope to young people that there is a future for them at the end of school. So I have said we will give a free bus pass to all 16 to 18 year olds in Greater Manchester. Why? Because I want them to have hope, and that for me is the best way to build a cohesive society, if the next generation, the coming generation, has hope that they can build Greater Manchester together. So with the right experience, with that strong, experienced voice on the national stage and a vision for what we can be in the future, I ask for your support on May the 4th.
Thank you, Andy. Next up is the United Kingdom Independence Party candidate, Schneur Odze.
Thank you, and thank you, Nathan, for that kind of introduction. What can I say? We were with Jackie Mason. Thank you for our hosts. I've never ceased to be amazed and impressed by what vision and a lot of commitment and determination can do. Here in KD, thank you to the JLC for all that they do, not only for tonight. I'm standing as a youth representative, in part to dispel a myth about my party and the people that support us in terms of what they aspire to and what they wish to achieve. UKIP had the highest number of African-American candidates in the last general election, had previous party treasurer, Jewish party treasurers, and a previous chairman who was Jewish. Shout out! Change in the way the services are delivered. Whilst the established parties will talk about protecting the frontline services, we don't hear them talk much about the closure of 10 major police station custody suites in Greater Manchester. So you can talk the talk, but you've got to walk the walk. When they talk about protecting the NHS, and yet are downgrading key services and merging specialist acute services, which are not in the interest of patients who want a local good service, and that the very same people go wrong with their placards in front of those very local services that their colleagues are closing, you need a party that actually will connect the talk with the walk, the words with the action. It's because I believe we need a different vision, a vision somewhere between pie in the sky and more of the same. When it comes to transport, talking about not having an anti-car policy, the overwhelming majority of Greater Manchester voters against the congestion charge, I will not contemplate congestion charge under my watch. I will have a zero-based review of our transport policy, which will include the park and ride scheme, which is underused, isn't used at all, and if it passes it, at a great cost. To have an Oyster car system so we can properly integrate our buses, trains, and trams so they actually work, because we can talk all we like about giving up free bus passes and reducing fares, but if you don't get the volume onto the transport, it won't pay for itself. Unless somebody can identify a pot of gold at the bottom of the rainbow, we need to find a way of paying for these services. Housing and so many other things have been poorly organized when it comes to building the housing we need, but also the infrastructure that needs to go with it. But fundamentally, I belong to a party that doesn't see a challenge in Brexit, but sees an opportunity in Brexit. Whilst I also favour recycling, and I welcome all people, all converts, to the cause of Brexit, my party was a single party that championed it, that actively campaigned for it, for what 52% of the population believed in, because they believe in far better. They believe for too long we have underestimated ourselves, underestimated our ability, underestimated the opportunities we have to go out there and trade with the world. Our values is not just a fluttering flag high on a mast, but it actually represents something which the Jewish community came here, and often more British than the natives. Just round the corner, the Jewish hospital, which arguably was the blueprint for the NHS, a community that engrossed itself, invested in education and prosperity without forgetting its social responsibility to its own, its needy, but the wider community too. And that very much, as fellow candidates have alluded to, is a blueprint for where I see Greater Manchester going. But very much, I don't believe we need a mayor that's a technocrat, that's a big Mr. I Am, that's going to manage and run and dictate everything. Because it can't be in every single ward and every single police station running it. You need to have the vision, you need to empower the staff. So that's why the cornerstone of my administration will be a new compact in local government, a transparent and open administration. In America, so a whistleblower is a hero. In England, they're drummed out of town. We don't need to refer to too many examples where people, both from the public and the private sector, who've spoken out of genuine concern and imperative to improve, have been treated as pariahs, as traitors, and have paid great personal price. Under my administration, whistleblowers will be championed, embraced, and celebrated. And that way will be another way we'll improve our public sector. Thank you.
Green Party candidate, Will Patterson.
Thank you, Chair, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Firstly, I think following on from Nathan's introduction, I think that's possibly the best warm-up act we've ever had at one of these hustings. So, can we book you for all the others? But I'd like to introduce myself. As was said, my name is Will Patterson. I am the Green Party's candidate for mayor. And I'm standing in this election because this is a completely new post. It's a completely new way of delivering government in this country. The system we've got is untried on this side of the Irish Sea. The closest we've had to a mandatory coalition is the Good Friday Agreement. And, well, I think we know how that's working out at the moment. So this idea of the mayor working in formal coalition with all 10 council leaders is a new development, and it does demand a new approach. The approach of Westminster with the two sword lengths at either side isn't really the way forward, I see. And it's because of that, it's because this is a completely level playing field in terms of experience, that I come to this with a new vision. You know, I recognise that my cabinet level experience comes with IKEA more than anything else, but I have experience living in Greater Manchester, looking for somewhere to live in Greater Manchester, working in Greater Manchester and looking for work in Greater Manchester, caring for a parent with mental health difficulties, travelling on our public transport network. And it's through all of these experiences that I've been at the sharp end of the decisions that politicians have taken. I recognise, as I know all of you do, that the decisions we take have real life consequences for people on the ground. And it's those consequences that I will bear in mind in every act I take if I'm elected mayor. That's why I know that we need to take real action on housing, not on executive homes or on luxury high-rise flats, but on the housing that we actually need in Greater Manchester, social and affordable homes. We need to take real action on homelessness. I think it's a travesty that while councillors champion these high-rise developments, they're doing nothing for the people sleeping on the streets beneath them. And we need to take action to solve these issues today. We need to start now. We need to make sure that our transport system is fit for the people who live here in Greater Manchester. It's not right that we should cheerlead for vanity projects to London when the local rail services are so completely neglected and our everyday passengers have to go through conditions that really don't befit a 21st century rail network or 21st century public transport network. If we can't get Bolton to Manchester right, if we can't get Wigan to Manchester right, how on earth can we get Manchester to London right? It's basic common sense approaches like these, taking the care of the basics, that's going to be at the heart of what I do. It's about making sure that when we talk about Greater Manchester, we make sure that we're talking about the whole of Greater Manchester, not just about the city, but about the city region, all 10 boroughs, and making sure that our plans do actually benefit all 10 boroughs, because We were told when we were sold this great Devo Mank idea that it was about answering the over-centralisation of the British economy and the British political life on London and the South East. Well, if we want to make this idea a success, the last thing we want to do is repeat that mistake by over-centralising on Manchester City Centre and Salford Quays. And that's why I'll be mindful of all 10 boroughs. And that's why it's part of my transport plan, is to create an outer circle line connecting all of Greater Manchester's community on the Metro Link. And it's about openness and accountability as well. Because I've been following the developments of devolution since the Ink on the First Agreement was dry. And I have to say, I think it's got off to a bad start. I think it's got off to a bad start because we've had so little consultation. I think it's got off to a bad start because we've had so little engagement. When the Police and Crime Commissioner elections were called off, there was a consultation on that. But that consultation closed a couple of weeks after the elections were meant to be held. And so we need to tackle anomalies like that. We need to take real action to get out to communities, listen to members here tonight and in the community venues like this across Greater Manchester. So that's my vision here. It's about listening to the people. It's about delivering real action on the issues that matter. This isn't just a powerhouse, it's our house. Let's build it together.
All of the candidates. So I have 9 questions here. We're not going to get through all of those. So I'm going to call people to ask their questions. And a reminder that each candidate has 2 minutes to answer the question. We're going to start immediately to my right and then go across with each question. Move along, and so everybody will get a chance to answer first. So the first question that I have is from Sally Hallam. Sally, just wait for the microphone and then please ask your question to the candidates.
Thank you. Good evening. Post-Brexit, how do you see Manchester's role in the world?
Thank you. Jane Grove.
Thank you for the question. Post-Brexit, I think I see Greater Manchester as being having close links with Europe. Absolutely. I'm not sure that most people really wanted Brexit now that we're going forward with it. And I'd like to see a second referendum on the deal with Brexit, because I think we don't actually know what this is going to look like yet. And although I'd like to reach out to all people in Greater Manchester who voted to leave Europe and to remain, reaching out to all those people. People who voted leave, I would say to them, actually, are you sure this is what you wanted? And we need to have a say on the deal that we're going to get. And for those who voted remain, it's going to be a long process, isn't it? So my view is we've got a Brexit minister in Greater Manchester, and I think we need a seat at the table for that person. And we want to have somebody there who will want to keep the closest possible link with Europe, because I think that benefits us all. I think we're only starting to see now through the process of negotiation just how much of our laws are intertwined with Europe and how complicated it's going to be. And all the things we're going to lose as a result of coming out of Europe. For example, on our education, we're going to lose the research programmes. We're going to lose, I work for the NHS, we have people from Europe who are EU citizens who work in the health and social care. Those people feel insecure in their jobs now, we need to keep them, reach out to them. We're now having problems with Gibraltar. So I think many of these issues are unravelling and people understand now how complex it's going to be. So I would say what we need is to maintain those links with Europe as strong as possible. Once we have a deal that Theresa May is negotiating for us, it's going to take a few years. I'd like a referendum on that deal so that people can have a genuine say whether they actually want to go ahead with Brexit or not. That's my view. Thank you.
I mean, I take a different view to Jane. I think if we keep rerunning the argument of the referendum, we're never going to come back together as a society. In Greater Manchester, 600,000 people voted remain. I was one of them. 700,000 people voted to leave. It's quite divided, and we have to start to bring people back together. And the way we do that is start to think practically about the future and get a deal, a Brexit deal that works for Greater Manchester. I've challenged Theresa May and David Davis in the House of Commons, demanding that seat at the table. I've got a commitment to a meeting straight after the mayoral election. What I believe we need is a Brexit Committee of the Nations and Regions, so that there's a permanent voice for the Mayor of Greater Manchester in those discussions. Because my great fear would be, we're about to get a London-centric Brexit. You know, top of the list for the government will be protecting the City of London, make no mistake about that. And you need somebody who can shout up for industry and jobs here, and that is what I will do. Going beyond, and to answer your question about the role in the world, we've got to argue for a deal that preserves Greater Manchester as an outward-looking, pro-European city that is open to the world. So we need reform to immigration that does least damage to our economy. And more broadly, we need to start to proclaim Manchester's ambitions in the world. I've said we'll hold a digital summit here within 100 days of being elected. Why? Because I want the world to know where Manchester thinks we're going to be strong in the future. And digital is one of them, I think low carbon too. But the last point, and I think to truly answer your question, I hope Greater Manchester can stand for something different in a time when people may be having different views about the rest of the UK. Where is the UK going? Is it becoming more isolationist? We should stand for something better. You know, a place that welcomes people in, yes, is pro-business and pro-prosperity, but in true to Manchester's long tradition, is radical when it comes to social reform. I want this place to be a beacon of social justice, so others can look here and take inspiration and say, do you know what, Britain hasn't changed. That's the Britain we know. And I think we've got a big role in making sure that a positive vision of Britain is still projected by Greater Manchester going forward.
I do not want to rehearse the arguments for Brexit, not because I didn't believe in them, it's because that's looking backwards, I want to look forwards. As I alluded to before, I don't see Brexit as a challenge, I see it as an opportunity. Manchester was built on trade with the rest of Britain, with the world. Increasingly the European Union is a 19th century protectionist racket and inhibited our trade with our natural kith and kin in the Commonwealth, but particularly with the growing markets, the BRICS and other nations. So thankfully we are going through a low, historical, relatively low unemployment phase, but I want to see jobs that pay, high-skilled jobs, and that's why one of my commitments are through lifelong training for workers, because increasingly we don't have jobs for life. Brexit will allow us to do that. Somebody alluded to the NHS. Part of the problem with the skills shortage in the NHS is we can't recruit lower income staff from outside the EU. Post-Brexit, we can then decide for ourselves what who we can, what we'd like to bring in based on need. As a governor of Withenshaw, that was an increasing thing. Every single meeting was, we've got a skill shortage and we can't recruit the staff from within the EU. So Brexit very much is an opportunity. Yes, rather develop our ties with the European Union, we're not anti-Europe, but the EU. There will also be an opportunity to speak up against HS2, the only party that doesn't want to waste billions and billions down a black hole that will take the jobs and employment away from Greater Manchester. Okay, admittedly the Greens are also against HS2, and I welcome their support and support of that, so we can invest in local and regional transport. So Brexit is an opportunity for us to reconnect with the world and be far more prosperous for all.
Thank you very much.
Will Patterson.
Well, HS2 is something that Schneur and I do agree on, so let's try and celebrate agreement where we can. In terms of Brexit, I'll be quite candid here. I think the people of Greater Manchester, the people of the United Kingdom, were sold a pop. We had £350 million for the NHS dangled in front of us. That ain't happening. We were told that Turkey was on the verge of joining. That ain't happening. We were told that we were going to take back control of our government. And instead we got Theresa May's Henry VIII clause, actually seeing more powers pushed towards her government and Parliament sidelined. So I think we have been sold a pup. And certainly I think you deserve a voice in Greater Manchester who won't put up with the people being misled in this way, who will actually hold people to account for the promises that were made. But in terms of my vision for Greater Manchester post-Brexit, frankly, my vision is the same one whether we had voted to remain or to leave. To give you an example, just this weekend, we've seen the entire global green movement converge just down the road in Liverpool. So I'm the only person on this panel who's part of a global movement for change with genuine global ambitions. And I want to harness that. I see Greater Manchester as a beacon, somewhere that can really take a radical path, make ethics and sustainability at the heart of our business model a unique selling point, make Maiden Greater Manchester a shorthand for responsibility and reliability. It's that radical vision of taking real action on climate change and on social justice that's my vision for a global Greater Manchester as an inspiration to the rest of the world.
Thank you.
Well, I think Greater Manchester has, you know, Greater Manchester is home to the Industrial Revolution. It's home to it's at the heart of the Northern Powerhouse, the Northern Powerhouse agenda that I think is even more important post the vote than it was pre the vote. You think about Manchester and Greater Manchester as an international city. In and of itself, it needs to ensure that it's working with the cities of the North in order to be able to attract the investment that we need and have an economy of the size and scale that would make us noticeable across the world. So I think that's important. There's a couple of things that I think we need to get out of these negotiations. It's not just a seat at the table. This Brexit negotiating table that everybody wants to be around is going to be so large that nobody's voice will be heard. I want Greater Manchester out there trading with government, with the rest of the world, as new trade deals are done. I want to make sure our interests are represented in those deals. I want to make sure that Greater Manchester has been a net recipient of funding from the European Union in the past. It pays for a lot of our skills activities and a lot of transport infrastructure investment. That needs to be replaced, and we need to make sure that that happens. We need to think about how regulation that perhaps previously has stifled businesses, and state aid rules are one of them, where we may be able to support Greater Manchester businesses in a way that we haven't been able to in the past. We should be able to take those opportunities. And most importantly, we need to support our universities here in Greater Manchester so that we can continue to be a home of science and innovation and research, and to support international students coming to Greater Manchester. If we do those four things, then I think we're setting ourselves up to give us the best possible chance to make the most of the opportunity. I also think we need to have one of the reasons why people voted to leave was because they thought power was too far away from them. It was in Brussels. And as we repatriate power from Brussels to the United Kingdom, that shouldn't mean a centralisation of power in Westminster. So there should be a concurrent conversation about the redistribution of powers across the nation at the same time. Two quick points. And the need to upskill our domestic population has never been greater as a result of this. And if we have a plan, investor confidence for me is important. Having a plan for us to go out and trade with the world will be one of the ways that we can ensure that we get what we need in Greater Manchester as we leave.
Okay, so we'll move on to the next question, and that is from Heather Fletcher. Heather's on the front row here.
Yes, good evening. I'm Councillor Heather Fletcher from Swinton in Salford, but I'm not going to ask you any questions about what you're going to do for Salford. Instead, my question is as follows. In view of the rise in hate crime against all cultures and faiths following Brexit, and the even higher levels of anti-Semitism recently, what importance do all the candidates place on interfaith work in Greater Manchester? And what solutions would you propose to implement?
Thank you, Heather. So to start with that one, Andy Burnham.
Well, thank you, Heather. I mean, it is incredibly worrying, isn't it? The growing levels of hate crime. See, I think they're probably underreported as well. I think there are many more incidents that people don't tell the police about. So I think we should be under any illusions, the problem is a very, very serious one indeed. It starts with ourselves, I would say, politicians, and the messages that we send out. I worry that some of the handling of Brexit isn't helping, as I said, bring us back together. You know, the failure to give EU nationals security in terms of their permission to stay here was a big mistake, in my view, because it's left a kind of cloud hanging over everyone and everywhere, and it's created uncertainty in communities. I have a Polish community nurse who came to my surgery recently to say that every morning as she gets into her car to go out on her round to deliver insulin to diabetics who are housebound, she hears a shout of "Go home" out of one of the houses opposite. The nice thing was that five of her neighbours came with her to say we don't want that in our street, but still, that is the reality. So they should, in my view, have just secured the rights of people. The government still haven't done that, and they should do that. But more broadly, to answer your question, obviously, you can't be carrying on cutting the police when you've got rising hate crime all over the country. The police cuts should stop. We should give more stability to the funding of organisations like the Community Security Trust. They do an incredible job. Let's give them long-term funding so they can lock more volunteers to be able to contribute. Let's make it easier for people to report hate crime on Metrolink and on buses with a simple reporting system that those organisations could help with too. But the last point, we need to, at the mayoral and combined authority level, have an interfaith dialogue. And we need to show from the very top that all faiths in Greater Manchester are involved in discussions with the mayor and with the combined authority. So to answer your question directly, if I'm elected on the 4th of May, I will establish a permanent such body that will ensure that all faiths are represented and regularly consulted on all of the work of the mayor and the combined authority.
Thank you, Councillor Fletcher. It's a very difficult question for me, and it's something that I've given over the years a lot of thought to. Growing up, you know, how many times walking from Hackney to the West End on Shabbos was I shouted at or spat at or had my hat knocked off? It was something I grew up with and always took for granted. Canvassing across the country, particularly in the inner cities, is an occupational hazard, and that's long standing. But it's impossible to avoid the fact that the reason we have security guards in our schools and hospitals, and let's take this moment to thank the last Conservative administration that moved from rhetoric, the promise of this funding, to actually delivering this funding, which they deserve the credit for. It's because we're facing a certain threat. And when there are colleagues of yourself that are rightly lauded for their interfaith work, but then are sharing fake news, which stigmatizes and delegitimizes Jews and by proxy Israel, you've got to ask yourself, are we speaking with a forked tongue? Where we need to have a city region that people have experiences of each other, not just knowledge of each other. We don't need all people to feel that they are part of it, not to say that because of your legitimate, may not agree with it, views or practices, you shouldn't be standing for election, because that is a very slippery slope. And so, you know, respecting people is very, very important. Interface work is really important, but it's not just knowledge of, it's experience of. And that's why, as a mayor, I want to bring people together, not just to talk about each other, but actually have joint experiences, because I think in our small way, that will make the most meaningful difference.
Thank you.
Well, I think we have to start by recognising the unique double whammy that the Jewish community faces, both in Greater Manchester and across the country. The Jewish community is just as vulnerable to far-right hate and propaganda as it has always been. And at the same time, it's vulnerable to members who associate themselves with the far left and hijack criticism of Israeli government policy and turn that into a vehicle for attacking the Jewish community as a whole. I want to make it quite clear right here and right now that I deplore and deprecate any such attempts. But what I will say is that it goes beyond the Jewish community as well. There are so many dividing lines in the country, and for me, one of the tragedies of the Brexit vote is, I won't use the word challenge, I would say it's a tragedy. It's not the fact that we started talking about the border around the country, but the borders that it produced within the country, between different communities, regardless of faith, regardless of race, regardless of gender or sexual orientation, for example. And so it's absolutely right that we have that interfaith dialogue. It's absolutely right that the mayor goes out and actively seeks out community groups to work together and to have that dialogue, that colloquium between each other, so that we can understand each other better. A sustainable society is one in which every individual, regardless of faith, regardless of background, can take part to their fullest extent, and that's what I want to see. But there's one other thing I would say, and that is that while we're doing this, we have to make sure that we're protecting people properly. We have to make sure that the police are there and visible so that people can go to them with hate crime issues. But we have to be careful not to be protecting the people who are the vehicles for that crime in the first place, the far-right groups that are marching on the towns across Greater Manchester. I'm sick of seeing Greater Manchester police protecting far-right marchers and doing nothing for the people that they want to target. So my priority will be to defend the people, not the far-right.
Sean Anstee.
incredibly important question. I mean, hate crime in all of its forms is intolerable and needs to be dealt with in a way that is decisive, that is quick, and that gives people confidence, both in their police force but also within their communities, the issues that are being raised that have such a profound impact on people as a victim of crime, that they have absolute confidence that they will be responded to in a way that gives assurance, that gives a commitment to ensuring the Greater Manchester Police take all forms of crime very seriously, but also to undervalue the impact that it has on a family's life. It's not just actually the victim, it's the wider family as well, and that I think have impacted with hate crime. And what I would just say to it is, I said in my opening remarks that I want to have, so I want to give that confidence, but I also want to have a police time bank so we can get greater levels of community influence over Greater Manchester Police. I think that will be helpful to be able to give some assurance and response. But the thing that we also haven't talked about yet, and we should do, is what happens at early years and what happens in schools for people that are coming through our school system here in Greater Manchester, because not only is it intolerable and wrong and needs to be dealt with, but we also need to put steps and measures in place to try and prevent it in the first place and to get people to understand their responsibilities as a citizen of Greater Manchester and a citizen of this country. And so I want to focus very much so on what happens with young people and people's thinking very carefully about their rights. And with rights come responsibilities. They come responsibilities to be able to say that we live in a very open and tolerant Greater Manchester, and we profoundly benefit from that. And that's absolutely what we should be doing in future to ensure that we get young people off to the best start and right start in life at the same time.
Well, first of all, hate crime is a serious crime, whatever form it takes. Anti-Semitic or any kind of hate crime is serious. And as Mayor, I think leadership needs to be shown to make sure that's recognised. As Sean was saying, anybody who experiences hate crime needs to feel confident in going to the police to have it reported, to have it documented, to have it dealt with quickly and effectively. I also think that post-Brexit, we've experienced, unfortunately, that referendum did seem to unleash more of that sort of thing. I can think of a friend of mine in Timperley, who is an Indian background. Post that referendum vote, she was told to go home, and her home is Timperley, where she's always lived and her family lived. So I think that that was, we need to work with that and make sure we address that properly. I think interfaith work is really important. I think I agree with Sean and others on the panel about this. It's actually about working out what's the causes, what's going on, and but that is the beginning, isn't it? The beginning is in schools, how we bring up our children to understand people of other faiths, how we bring up our children to understand people of all different backgrounds and all different nationalities, cultures, religion, whatever the difference is, we need to make sure we address that. It's very hard with our young people and our children, and that's what I would do. And I'd like to work with them to be a tolerant internationalist, Greater Manchester, and I think as Mayor, the absolute priority is to make hate crime a serious crime and make sure that it's addressed both in the policing terms and at its root causes as well.
Additional points on that question? Do you mind if I'm sure make a point? 1 minute.
Just a brief point. So, I think you've heard a lot, that we would all agree, and that's great. That the candidates standing in this election all have a similar view, which I think is very important in and of itself. The thing I would just like to add is, I think we've all got an obligation too, though, to help the Muslim community right now. I visited a mosque last Friday, and they are incredibly despondent every time an incident happens, as it did in Westminster. And the feeling that's coming out from the Muslim community is, you know, they get the generalisations on Twitter before we'd even found out what happened, who did it, what was their background. And as it turns out, this was a real loner, wasn't it? This was somebody with no connection. And they were saying, you know, if anybody now, just a loner, can just come and commit something like that, then we all get the blame for it. All of our community becomes tarnished instantly again. And it is really worrying in the climate of social media that this happens like that. You know, the person who perpetrated the attack on Westminster, in my view, no more represents the Muslim community than the man who killed my friend Joe Cox represents the Christian community. And I think it's really important for us all to pull together in moments like this, and all of us say that, because otherwise the terrorists start to win, because the division starts to build. And I just think it's really important to the interfaith side of it, and all of us speaking for each other at moments like that is really very, very important.
Thank you.
Looking at this, I was at a school's question time in Parswater last week, on the day of the attack actually. We didn't know it was happening while we were holding the event. And there was a girl in the hijab who came up to me afterwards expressing despair that there was a presumption of guilt almost against her community, the sort of assumption that it was behind terrorism, and we know that's not the truth. The truth is extremists in all communities that cause such damage. But this is nothing new. We look back to the miscarriages of justice of the 70s and 80s with the Birmingham Six and the Guildford Four. We need to stop tarnishing communities and start targeting individuals. We need to do our job properly and seek out those who carry out terror, not demonise entire communities.
Okay, let's take the next question.
Has increased over the last few years, and concentrating on the city centre, how is it that a city like Manchester, with its wealth and compassion, has allowed this situation to occur, can't provide assistance to such poor people, and how would the candidates tackle this?
Thank you. So first with that one is Schneur Odze.
So very often when we've discussed this campaign, homelessness, we seem to focus on rough sleeping. And rough sleeping is only one terribly important but small aspect to homelessness, which needs to be tackled, and invariably it's not just a problem with housing, it's less to do with housing, to do with more crisis and other services which are pushing these people onto the street. So we do need to build more homes, but to an appropriate kind of homes for the need that exists. But just to have gimmicks and say, I will prioritise this person or that person, gerrymandering the points-based system we have for housing applications, it's just going to solve the problem on somewhere else or someone else. And therefore, yes, we need to build a home. We need to have a council, a social housing building program, a council housing building program like we haven't had before. And we need to support the services that, when you talk about rough sleeping, the services that help these people that for multiple reasons end up on the street. And we also need to, what London is doing now, is have genuine surveys of those people that are sleeping rough and understand where is they're coming from and why they are on the streets. And I think that the answer to that will inform very much why there's been a terrific spike in the last few years in rough sleeping, which we see and often is just behind our eyesight. So it's, you know, people who are living in poor accommodation, too small accommodation, couch surfing, etc.
Well, Schneur touched on some important points there, that homelessness isn't just about rough sleeping. There are people who are couch surfing. Of course, they're completely missed by the system all the time because we can see the ones on the street. We can't see the ones who are moving from address to address, so that's something we do need to look at. But looking in terms of rough sleeping, we need to make sure that we are actually counting people properly. Local councils do have a responsibility to count how many rough sleepers there are in their area. But we get a scene, for instance, where one council in Greater Manchester is carrying out that count at 2 o'clock on a Wednesday afternoon. Now, let's be blunt, how many people is it going to find at 2 o'clock on a Wednesday afternoon? So we need to actually knock some heads together at council level to begin with, to actually really find out just how serious the problem is, and get the real numbers before we can even begin to address this properly. We need to start using vacant public buildings as well as homeless shelters. We had the ones in Human Harper Hay that we used last winter. We need to get them back on the grid, back into service, to make sure we can get roofs over as many heads as possible. And as well as that, we need to look at the vulnerable groups. We need to make sure there's suitable provision for victims of domestic violence, for instance, that they have somewhere to go. They don't have a choice between staying with an abusive partner or going out on the street. We need to make sure that, for instance, the LGBT community is covered. So, for instance, in their case, it's been discovered that among young homeless people, almost 25% identify as LGBT. So right away, if we can actually tackle that side of things, engage with that community better, we can reduce homelessness, we can reduce rough sleeping by a massive proportion just by engaging with specific communities. So it's about getting a roof over every head, starting to tackle smaller properties, but building properties that can beat the bedroom tax, and making sure that the groups that need the most help get it.
So I think you're absolutely absolutely right that actually what you see in Greater Manchester at the moment is an economy that's booming and people that don't feel like they're benefiting from it. And that gap actually is pretty significant in some parts of Greater Manchester between those that are away and those that are in. And if devolution is to mean anything to us, it's about connecting employment and skills, housing and health and social care and wellbeing, policing together. And housing and homelessness services are primarily the responsibility of local authorities. Manchester City Council, I think, has a tremendously tough job actually to see people move into the city centre who have no choice really to do that. And it's an absolute travesty. But I think where the mayoralty can help is to say that you no longer try and support somebody off the streets in isolation of those other things that are going to be needed to then ensure that they can stay off the street. And that's the key point for me. A couple of things that I think we need to do with that. What we do when we try and support homeless people off the streets is we say in isolation, well, we're just going to get you off and we'll give you somewhere warm to stay. And then we'll give you some skills qualifications at the same time and try and support you that way, some health and social care. We need to do more than that. We need to work with employers actually to stimulate demand for people who have different backgrounds, who perhaps have been homeless or perhaps come out of prison. Because until we do that, we're not creating independence for people, which is what they need to be able to stay off the streets over a longer term. And I think we'll have the powers and responsibilities to be able to make a lasting impact on not just, like I say, just dealing with the immediate issue, but also then making sure that it's sustainable. Similar to the point that I said before, I think if we think about the things that cause somebody to be homeless, whether that's their housing status, whether that's their employment status, whether it's their mental health and well-being, we will have the powers to be able to do something so directly about it in a way that we haven't been able to do in the past.
It's an important thing, homelessness, because we see it all the time. It's distressing when you see it and you want to reach out to people, you want to help them. We feel like, you know, we're okay, but we want to reach out to people. It's a complex problem as well. There's no one reason why someone's homeless, and I think that's where we've got to look at the root causes of why people are homeless. It's not going to be a quick fix. I don't believe just throwing money at the problem is going to fix that solution. I think what we need to look at is what are the root causes and address those over a long term. So some of these have already been identified. I think the key ones are probably things like mental health issues, drugs and alcohol problems. It might be sort of social background as well, maybe domestic violence or, you know, maybe relationship issues. It's all sorts of problems. It could be somebody coming out of prison. It could be many, many issues. And if we don't address the root causes, we're not going to tackle the issue at all. So I think this is where the Mayor does have a really good opportunity, because that's one of the great things about the position of Greater Manchester Mayor, is all the services come together under one kind of decision-making body. And that's where we can look at linking together the social care, the mental health problems, the policing is also in there as well. So I think by working together in these partnerships, we can start to address the problem, but it's going to be a long-term issue, and we need to start looking at things like wider affordable housing and looking at things like the rented sector as well, and just looking at the real reasons why people are homeless. It might be financial, or maybe there's so much we can do, but we need to make a start on that, and let's get going and see what we can do together.
It's a very serious issue. You deserve a really specific answer. I don't think you've had one yet, so I'm going to try and give you one. But firstly, why is it happening? It's happening because the cuts have gone too far. Cuts to mental health services, cuts to drug and alcohol services, cuts to social care. I'm afraid this is what happens when we have a right-wing government in sometimes. They go too far. They tear a hole in the safety net that should be under every community, and some people fall through it. And those people can be seen all over Greater Manchester now, not just in the city centre. And it's not good enough actually just to come out with some bland statements. The government are about to cut housing benefit for 18 to 21 year olds. That will put more young people on the streets of city centre Manchester. It is not good enough. It needs clarity, it needs a plan to deal with it. I will set a new goal of ending rough sleeping by 2020. Not by throwing your money at it, public money at it, but by building a new voluntary approach that I will lead by donating 15% of my mayoral salary to create a new voluntary fund to tackle homelessness. I want to look other people in the eye in Greater Manchester and ask them to do the same. And I've already got many offers of support. I've appointed Ivan Lewis, MP for Bury South, will be known to many of you, and Councillor Beth Nold, to head up what I'm calling a homelessness action network. The purpose of that will be to bring together other individuals and organisations who feel the same passion about wanting to do something, to get offers of buildings, of food, of furniture, of money. So we build a resource across Greater Manchester that can be used to develop localised solutions to tackle this problem. The point is, the final point I would say about this is, it is perfect, nobody should accept that in 2017 it's an inevitable fact of life that some people have to spend the night on cold streets. The type of people that we are in Greater Manchester, nobody walks past without caring about the people who are there. I think if we had a fund as well, by the way, it would be easier for people to donate to that rather than feel they have to give funds to people on the streets. We can do better on this. We should do better on this. The idea we've got ex-forces out there because they're not being looked after is quite frankly scandalous. I will lead from the front on this issue. I spoke earlier about making Greater Manchester a beacon of social justice for others. This is exactly what I mean by that phrase, that here there is no rough sleeping. And I believe if we achieve that by 2020, that will provide inspiration to the rest of the country that something better can be done.
For homelessness services that are provided, and it's not an issue just about money, so it's not a case of saying that this is a bland answer. This is about saying that we have an opportunity in Greater Manchester in May to respond to how we deal with homelessness in a very different way to what we've been able to before, to do it in a way that is much more holistic, much more cohesive. That's not just a case of saying that we've got more money to do things. It's about saying that if we're going to do something very different with devolution, we need to ensure that somebody understands the detail of those agreements. And the second thing I'd say, and it was the other part of the question, was if economic growth in Greater Manchester is going to continue to happen, and we need to choose about how we respond to that. We've got to plan for new homes and new jobs in Greater Manchester over the next 15 to 20 years. Because if we don't, then all we're going to do is perpetuate this disparity between those who are able to progress in the city region and those who are not. If we have a plan in place, and I'm one of the only candidate here in Greater Manchester that is committed to getting through a plan that links inclusive growth to the population of Greater Manchester in a way that will ensure that we have practical, pragmatic ways of dealing with these issues in the first place.
Well, my background is in public health, and one of the key things about enabling people from difficult situations is about how their self-esteem, their empowerment, and a lot of this can really work with the voluntary sector. But one of the things that we've got to work with for homeless people is, having read up a lot about it and looked at what people really need when they're homeless, it's often that empowerment, that ability to take the next step. And people need to find that within themselves and be supported in finding that within themselves. Just having lots of services isn't necessarily going to enable people to take that step away from homelessness. So it's got to be a multifaceted approach. It's got to be looking at where people are already homeless, what services do they need to support them. It's also looking at prevention as well. So it's got to be a big, big project, this. So homelessness is going to be a big issue. For a big issue, that's could be a joke, couldn't it? But actually, the big issue is one of the organisations that supported homeless people, and what they did was gave them employment and something to do and something worthwhile to make that step into something, but also prevention as well.
Yeah, I have to say, in terms of the spatial framework that Sean was alluding to there, I think we have to look at this quite clearly and ask ourselves, if a 20-year plan to build executive homes on the Greenbelt is going to solve rough sleeping, when it's building high-value houses on high-value land, I think we need to look again at the plan there. We need to rewrite it, replace the spatial framework as it currently stands with a people's housing plan that tackles the needs we really have, rather than trying to bulk up the council tax base.
Back on something that Sean said, because Sean began his reply saying we've got 9 Labour councils here in Greater Manchester, as though it's the fault of the Labour councils that there are people homeless. I just don't accept that. Our councils are being targeted for bigger cuts than councils in other parts of the country. It's not their fault. This government is targeting them for cuts, having promised us a northern powerhouse. It then gives our northern councils even bigger cuts. I believe that the school we're sitting in tonight is going to be hit very hard under the new school funding formula that this government is proposing. Every single secondary school in this borough, Manchester, in Wigan and Lee, in Rochdale and in Trafford, in Shoresborough, are going to lose heavily under the new school funding formula. Now, how on earth can that possibly be right or fair? So I'm afraid to say it's not good enough. You need a mayor who's going to stand up to a government who's doing this. He won't just nod it all through, but actually will stand up to them and call them out, and that is what I will do.
Right, thank you. I think we're going to be able to get two more questions in, so the next question will be from Robert Marks, please.
Thank you. If we saw a repeat of the 2014 demonstrations outside Kedah in the city centre and a repeat of the extreme anti-Israel activity, how would you as mayor deal with that, and what principles and policies would you put in place to make sure it couldn't happen again?
Thank you. Will Patterson.
Well, firstly, as I said before, what I said about far-right extremism applies across the board. We should not be protecting extremism. We should not be protecting extremist marches. We should not be protecting the people who want to target vulnerable groups. So I will start a complete zero-tolerance approach to any group that is a platform for hate speech. I will make sure that the police are actually protecting the residents, not the protesters, and I will apply that night watchman approach there. I won't support any funding for demonstrations that divide our community. I won't support any funding for demonstrations that victimise our community, and that applies across the board.
And again, I think there's something about leadership in trying to answer that question. It's both the things that we do to be able to respond to actions as they're being taken, actions that clearly are not have no place in Greater Manchester, no place in the country, frankly. To say that we need to create a community in Greater Manchester that celebrates our diversity and champions our togetherness. The police force need to be able to respond to demonstrations that clearly are having such an impact on the everyday lives of businesses and people across Greater Manchester. That confidence that we've referred to earlier on in the debate today means that it's responded to quickly. But I also think that the mayoralty itself, the combined authority, needs to be able to be setting the standard for the type of Greater Manchester that we want to be in the 21st century and in the future. And that's one that is open, that is tolerant, that is saying that these things which are so distasteful, actually, and so inappropriate, that they're stamped out quickly. And then I think we can do that through both the response of Greater Manchester Police, but also then the leadership, political and civic leadership that is given to the aftermath of any event to ensure that there's that confidence that people need to see.
Well, I think the role is going to be an important role because the new mayor will be your police and crime commissioner, and again, that is a position of leadership. I think that when it comes to demonstrations and marches and things like that, we've got to make sure the police are allowed to do their job, but we've also got to make sure that things that are not meant to be happening are dealt with properly. I don't know that much about this specific example, but I would say that anything that is happening that is going to be the hate crime or is going to be causing disharmony, all those things need to be dealt effectively, properly and early on to make sure we keep everyone safe. Because after all, the role of the police is there to keep everyone safe, and we need to make sure the police can get on with that job, but also with the right leadership, so that we don't tolerate anything that's hate crime or anything that's socially divisive. So I agree with much of the panel on this. I think you'd probably find we're all going to speak with a similar voice. Thanks.
Well, simple, we want no repeat of it. I do remember this specific example, and I remember reading the accounts that were being tweeted on the day, and it got very ugly indeed, and we don't want it. You know, it's destabilising, it's threatening for the community, but it's also going to project the wrongish image of Greater Manchester, isn't it, around the world. We want to be open to the world. We do not want people going about their lawful, legitimate business being targeted in this way. So it is about leadership, as others have said. It is about sending out the strongest possible message, as Sir Richard Lees and Sir Howard Bernstein did at the time. And it's about working with the police to make sure there isn't a repeat. People have a right to free speech, of course they do, but they do not have a right to disrupt the lawful business activity of other companies. And the line was crossed in this case, and we shouldn't have any repeat.
Both on this and on the previous question on anti-Semitism, I'd like to put on record the fact that I think Greater Manchester Police and the police in this country do an amazing job in both, not just in the day, it was a whole, you know, weeks and weeks of what went on around Kedem, but also protecting us around the holidays and other special occasions. I think the police can't say no, and therefore they're lumped on by all the other services, and that's why they're struggling so. To an extent, this is the price we pay for democracy. It's lawful expression of free speech, which we may not necessarily agree with. I think there are things that could have been done and we should be doing in the future, like moving them back so people can conduct their lawful business, both going about and trading and everything else. Clamping down very strenuously on those on the fringes of these demonstrations that cross the line, both verbally and physically, as we experience. But I would say one thing more than anything else. If it does happen again, I will be there, and I know which side of the demonstration I will be on.
Okay, so we can move on to the next question. That will be from Shelley Rubenstein, please.
What will you do to... What will you do to address health and social care challenges given the current rationing by the government?
Thank you. So the first,
for
that is Sean
Anstee. So Greater Manchester is the only part of the of England that is going to have responsibility for health and social care at the Evolution in Greater Manchester. And a lot of people, when we were negotiating that deal a couple of years ago, a lot of people said, why on earth do you want to take on a health and social care system that we know is under pressure, and that's not unique just to Greater Manchester. One of the two prime motivations for it really, was one, that we know that the well-being of our population is intrinsically linked to skills, employment, to housing, to planning and other things. And so you can't create a Greater Manchester that has inclusive growth at its heart, that has well-being, unless you have responsibility for health and social care services at the same time. And so there's no decision about Greater Manchester that will be made without Greater Manchester now in our health and social care system. There is a huge opportunity to be able to integrate health and social care services across the city region, to say that we can get better value for the money that's spent in health and social care, but it's also designed on levels of subsidiarity, so that we know that the health needs of our communities are very different across the city region. So they're not even, you're going to go down deeper than just even at boroughs, you go into individual communities in Greater Manchester. And so I think we have the ability now to be able to say that we can respond in a way that puts people's well-being at the heart of what we do across the city region, to link it to the other things that the mayoralty and the combined authority will have a responsibility for. It's important to know that health and social care functions are primarily a responsibility for the combined authority, but the mayor, I think, will have huge soft influence over it, and they need to understand. And I think that, I have responsibility today as the leader of Traffic Council for social care services. I have some of the best social care services in Greater Manchester for the people that live in Trafford. I think we can make sure that we take best practice across the city region, share it, and make sure that we make a success of being responsible for our own health and social care decisions in Greater Manchester.
Okay, well, everybody's watching Greater Manchester, because this is a big devolution budget we've got. pot. I think it's something like £6 billion are coming, but the, well, it's not going to be directly the mayor's influence, but it will be actually a lot of soft power will go in. So I think a lot of leadership will need to be shown on this issue. I think what's happening in our hospitals is we're having a lot of people are staying in hospital longer than they really need to because the community care and the social care isn't working for us at the moment. And we need to look very deeply at what's going on. And we've got a big opportunity to make this work and make this right in Greater Manchester. And mental health services need to come on board with this as well. What I'm learning is that there's many different communities that require kind of special social care. I was reading in the documents preparing for this hustings that actually this is an issue for the Jewish community, that you know we need specialist health and social care for particular population groups. I think that's really important we have that diversity in the system. But I also think we need to look at the actual health outcomes of people in Greater Manchester. And this is going to affect everything in Greater Manchester in terms of our employment and the prosperity of our city. We've got a big health divide in terms of if you look at life expectancy, there are places in Greater Manchester where people live 10 years longer on average than others, and I think we've got to again get to the root causes of that, and a lot of that is around what we do as a Greater Manchester city. Now the Mayor will have a very important role to play in that because it's about how do we promote our public health. Lots of ways. It's about the infrastructure, for cycling, for walking, for us all to be healthy, for our green spaces, for our mental well-being. I think the Mayor will make sure this budget is run properly and the service integrated, but I don't think actually we've got enough funding. My party, the Liberal Democrats, we've fought for parity of esteem. It first came from the Liberal Democrats under Norman Lamb, and everybody's now agreeing with us, which is great. But we actually have got a programme to make sure we get proper investment in social care. Because even if we kind of rejig the budgets a little bit, it's not going to be enough. We actually need to find ways of bringing more funding into social care and community care. And only by bringing that extra funding in are we going to fix the real problems that exist within our systems. So I would leave you with that. The whole systems need to come together, to work together, but we also need more funding to make it all work properly.
Well, I'm not sure people have grasped the scale of the crisis that is implicit in your question. The Greater Manchester NHS is in crisis, as it is in the rest of the country. I was a health minister and then health secretary in the last parliament. We worked long and hard to turn around waiting times in the NHS. When we came to government in 97, people were waiting up to a year or more sometimes for operations, and we worked to bring in an 18-week standard. Now, I don't know if you all saw it in the news last week, but they just announced that that's going again now. And what I can tell you is you take that discipline off the NHS, get ready for year-long waits in the NHS. Again, that's implicit in your question, Shelley. That rationing will be back. And so whoever is Mayor of Greater Manchester needs to show real leadership when it comes to the NHS. And let me show you how I would do that. Firstly, I've long warned, and I did as Health Secretary, that if you cut social care to the bone, it will in the end drag down the National Health Service with it. Because we're failing to support people properly in their own homes. We're leaving older people trapped in hospital beds for weeks on end, and hospitals are collapsing under the pressure. You have to change the way that system works. I have argued that I will bring social care into the NHS so that we can begin to develop a home-to-hospital service that actually optimises people's care and uses the money properly. It will be challenging, but we can do better, I think, than we've got right now. There also needs to be a plan for workforce. The single biggest driver of the deficits on the hospital system is that they are in the grip of private staffing agencies because we haven't trained enough nurses. And that problem will get worse, actually, after Brexit. There'll be even bigger staff shortages. We have to have an ambitious plan for workforce to bring young people through in Greater Manchester and give them the ability to work in our NHS. So here's what I will do about that. I am going to say to any graduate in Greater Manchester who comes through in a nursing or midwifery or other clinical profession, that if they commit to our NHS for 5 years here in Greater Manchester, we will help pay off their tuition fees. And that seems to me to be a practical way of dealing with the problem. And how do we pay for it? Because we won't be putting the money funneling it into those private staffing agencies that are taking so much out of the NHS right now.
If there's one thing more than anything else that vexes me as mayor, and which there's no easy solution, it is the NHS and social care, because it's both the biggest crisis the mayor is going to face, but also a litmus test to what kind of community we are, where our priorities lie. I would say something very different. I'm not intensely relaxed about the contracting out of all social care services with private companies. Yes, they do it cheaper, but they don't do it better. I think we need to have a focus on the here and now, but an eye on the future, so we're developing more community organisations that are delivering social care. The hospital I was governor of in Wythenshawe, it was the first stage PFI, which settled it, it's crippling it today, is the root of the reason why it's been downgraded from an acute hospital. And that is something that we need to have a responsible mayor that's not just going to burst the bank and borrow for today and not think about the future. So social care needs a different approach. Yes, it needs to, we need to work in partnership more with councils, that they fulfill their responsibilities in assisting not just the elderly, but those with disabilities through their age demographics. They can go back to the house and live there comfortably, because that is not only cheaper, but it's best for them too. It needs a new approach, and it's something that, frankly, I think it's only going to generate more and more headlines in the future, because there is a silver bullet.
Well, one of the things that doesn't help is the ending of bursaries for student nurses, and I will demand that that's reinstated for starters. But the fact is that the devolution settlement we've got does devolve responsibility. We need to make sure that doesn't turn into blame. And Jane pointed out quite rightly that the mayor doesn't have direct powers but can get people around the table. And there is an expectation that our authorities here in Greater Manchester will have to do a lot more with a lot less resources. So what we do is we need to work with community organisations. It's that simple. And this is something that Andy and I have got direct experience of in Wigan. Wigan Council, to its credit, saw the budget cuts coming. They saw them coming a mile off. They managed to funnel some of their money into community improvements and then as well start working with community organisations to help deliver those services. Not the perfect model by any means, but it means those services keep going. It means voluntary community organisations can deliver care services, can help there, make sure that services are tailored to the individual, that they're tailored to the community, they're tailored to the local area. So that's something that we can really do, because it's happening right now in Greater Manchester. We can spread that innovation across the 10 boroughs by getting people around the table. But of course, if we're going to rely on the voluntary sector to do our work for us, it's right and proper that they're involved in the delivery. We were talking before about how I enjoy recycling. Sean actually recycled one of my lines before. I believe in a policy of a no decision about it without it. That means that if we can have businesses contribute to the debate on what their business rates are, we can have the voluntary organisations that are helping to deliver our social care policy actually in the room when we decide that social care policy. That's, for me, a common sense approach, making sure that everyone is in the room together, deciding where we go together. That's my approach.
Stop it being a thing. But actually, I think maybe this panel is demonstrating today there's more we agree on. We need to bring all parties together, that's all political parties, to work on a common framework for the NHS. I work in the NHS, I'm probably the only one on the panel here that leads a team of frontline workers. And what we don't want is endless politicians coming along and telling us how to run the service. What we need is politicians who are going to support the service and work together to get a framework that works for everybody. So I would appeal to everybody on the panel, everybody here, to support an all-party framework to come together to make the NHS better.
Points. I think what I'd just say, and I should remind the audience here that you know Andy did describe the devolution deal at the time as a Swiss cheese, a deal that if he was health secretary he would reverse it. So it is a remarkable conversion over the last few years to support health and social care devolution in Greater Manchester. Secondly, I don't want my social care services moving into the NHS. Trafford has some of the most independently inspected, high-performing services in the country. Wigan has just been rated as a good authority for children's social care by Ofsted last week. Why would you disrupt that? Actually, well, the issue is about how do we make sure that social services and healthcare services are working with each other, and you can do that through pooled budgets and so on. But we don't need another organisational shift of social care somewhere else. And the last thing I'd say is that this isn't just about money. Yes, money is important, and we should be making sure that Greater Manchester gets its fair share. but I don't believe that just throwing money at something makes it better. And so we've got to use this as our opportunity to say that we can take smarter decisions. That's the way that we'll make sure that our health and social care system in Greater Manchester is looking at people's well-being and how they get on in life.
Thank you. Well, actually, to be honest, Sean, I stand by what I said about the devolution deal, because if you've got the wrong mayor who doesn't believe in the NHS, they've got the potential to do real damage to it and the ability to really take away that N in NHS and make it a localised system. So it does. There are real issues here, so you need somebody who you can trust when it comes to the NHS, that has a passion for it, and I certainly have that. And actually, I think you're saying that it's all fine, your councils do their bit, the NHS does that bit. It doesn't work for people. The complexity of care is increasing in the 21st century. As people live longer, they have a mix of physical, mental and social needs. To say to people, oh, the council deals with that bit of your mum and dad's care and they do it over there, and the NHS does the physical bit over here, they're left telling the same story to everybody who comes through the door, and the care doesn't work. You have to go to a new approach. I believe the right way to go is an NHS for the whole person, physical, mental and social care, that starts in the home and works from there, and puts a multidisciplinary team around people and works to support them where they want to be. The time has come to rethink the NHS for the 21st century. The current model is clearly not working. A&E across Greater Manchester is going down and down and down. The biggest effect, the biggest root cause of that is the cuts to social care. You know, how the government can carry on cutting social care in the home, that is piling the pressure on our hospital system. You've got to do something radically different.
Will, and then Schneur, and then we're going to do the closing statements.
Well, certainly just blindly throwing money at something doesn't work, but neither does starving it of funds either. I want to make that entirely clear to begin with. But Andy and I think both smell the potential pitfall in the devolution deal, because we only need to look at Wales, for example. Now, whenever a Tory Prime Minister, whether it's David Cameron, Theresa May, is having a rough Prime Minister's questions when it comes to health policy, they always go, ah, but look at Wales, look at the mess they're making over there. But what they don't actually tell you is how the Welsh government's been starved of funds since 2010. So essentially, this has been a problem where they've starved the Welsh government of funds, they've had to make really difficult decisions about what they do. That's then led to a decline in services, and then the Tories then point the blame at the Welsh government. And commentators in Cardiff call that the war on Wales. I'm very, very worried that if we're not careful, the Tory government down in Westminster will replace the war on Wales with the mauling of Manchester. And I, for one, will not let them get away with it.
Just because we may or may not agree on the problem doesn't mean we necessarily agree on the solution. The integration of every single service under the NHS positively frightens me. And I've had, maybe second only to Jane, more experience in the NHS, with respect to Andy, than most people here. I feel threaten the freedoms and the improvements, the real improvements that have been made in Greater Manchester. I will say this, what's going on in North Pennine that people have been shouting about for years, particularly maternity services, thankfully it's not a Staffordshire situation, but I fear that could happen again. We need greater openness and transparency, and until the NHS is right and comfortable to put more services into it, is actually a big threat to our services.
Thank you. Well, those are all the questions we have time for. So now we're going to take closing statements from all of the candidates. So thank you very much for your questions, and our apologies that we've not had the time to get to the three or four whose questions came in but we couldn't handle. So we're going to go in reverse alphabetical order, and each candidate will have 2 minutes, and I am going to call the time at the end of those 2 minutes because I've got a couple of other things to do at the end. So to start off, the candidate for the Green Party, Will Patterson.
I think what's been striking in this debate is how much we've actually agreed rather than how much we've disagreed. And I think it's one of the great weaknesses of the devolution settlement that we've got, that we've not had a London-style assembly with a proportionally elected representation where all of the parties could get to work together and work for the benefit of Greater Manchester. But we are where we are. As I said at the start of the debate, this is a completely new role and it does demand a new way of thinking. And that's what I, as a member of the Green Party, offer. It's what I offer in terms of how we approach housing, how we approach transport, how we tackle the consequences of climate changes that hit Greater Manchester. And it's going to be about cooperation and consensus, and that's at the heart of the Green Party agenda. If you want someone who will reach out across the divide and work on the things that we can agree on, work on our common solutions, rather than find new dividing lines, that's what I offer. I said right at the start, and I stand by it, for all the rhetoric of this being the Northern powerhouse, this, for us, is more than a powerhouse. It's our house. Let's build it together.
I'm the candidate that's not running from my party's record of policies, but running on my party's platform and advocating my party's policies. I'm the candidate that believes Brexit will supercharge Great Britain and Manchester, Greater Manchester first and foremost, so that we can improve the economic prospects for all, have a more inclusive and united Greater Manchester, that whether it's people's education, transport, health, is good and is local, and everybody feels that they play a part of it. I'm an ambitious mayor, but also a realistic mayor. So no pie in the sky promises that fall flat as they have in London. Because Manchester deserves honest politics, and politics that works for all. So if you want the mayor that will protect the frontline services, that won't tax everything that moves, and will deliver for all people of Greater Manchester, vote UKIP.
Thank you. Candidate for the Labour Party, Andrew Burnham.
It's been a very good debate. Thank you, Simon. Thank you, everybody, for coming this evening. I just want to explain a little more in closing why I've chosen to put myself forward. I did go into Parliament 16 years ago in 2001, and the main thing I've always done in that time is challenge the London-centric country in which we live. I've always been a voice for the north of England, but I've seen in Westminster how it just doesn't work. We've got a highly centralised political system in which that London perspective on life dominates everything. You know, I saw that in many of the issues I've dealt with, particularly Hillsborough, where if they could have got away with ignoring people there crying for justice, they would have done. And that's the country that we've lived in. And I've seen that at first hand, and I want to change it. I was a voice for those people, and I'll be a voice for you. I am somebody who is grassroots in terms of my approach to politics. I'll be approachable, accessible. I will build a new politics with you from the bottom up. Because actually that system of ours has laid the seeds for this referendum result. It's left too many communities behind without a voice. And we've got a chance to correct it here and build a new form of politics involving all faiths, all communities in the work of the mayor. Bringing more people in to contribute, tackle an issue like homelessness and rough sleeping, as I said earlier. Put young people at the heart of everything that we do. The Westminster approach is to make them the target for cuts. Well, I'll make them my priority for investment, because you can't build a strong, cohesive, prosperous society if you carry on taking away hope off the next generation. It's time to do things differently. Manchester, Greater Manchester, has always, always done things differently, and been prepared to shake up that establishment. We saw that with the suffragette movement, the creation of the trade union movement, the cooperative movement. This place has always been the home of radical forward thinking. We need to do the same again. Greater Manchester has changed the world before. We now need to go out and do it again. I invite you all to join my campaign, and let's go out there and change politics in this country for the better. Thank you very much.
I've really enjoyed this hustings. I think there have been some great questions, some great contributions. Now, I think this role of mayor, it's going to be about bringing together all the services. And I think as a Liberal Democrat, I do offer something different, because I want to offer more hope, solution-focused ideas. I think it's about listening as well. I think where I stand is we want to make the role of mayor democratic and accountable. It's not just going to be one person who's the Greater Manchester mayor, it's how we run the whole conurbation, how we run the whole place. So I would offer something different there in terms of our grassroots approach, in terms of having decision-making taken at the appropriate level, so we have local communities that contribute and we don't just have top-down kind of decision-making from the mayor and from the combined authority. So I'm also offering real experience in the NHS. I think actually going back to what we really need to do, it's about bringing together the services, and there's a big part that was missed in some of the earlier discussions. I'm a carer. I care for my son who has significant mental health challenges and special needs. I think from that experience as well, we need to work with the voluntary sector and we need to work for better health outcomes for everybody. And I think that's where you get the things coming together. So you've got the policing, you've got the transport, you've got housing and the environment. We've got to look at the wider determinants of health, not just what the NHS do, not just what the services do, but what communities can do to come together and make things work. So I want to make Greater Manchester a shining beacon of tolerance, of integration, that's breaking down barriers between voters and politicians. I hope my legacy will be better health outcomes for everybody. So I say let's step forward and be the best we can be for Greater Manchester.
Thank you. And finally, the Conservative Party candidate, Sean Anstee.
Well, thank you very much to all of you and to everybody for being here this evening. It is fantastic. We're doing lots of these debates and it's fantastic to make them happen, because this mayoralty is important to us in Greater Manchester in Maine. We need to get it off to the best start. Just before I just give you my closing remarks, in advance of today we were sent a manifesto for the Jewish community for the Mayor of Greater Manchester. I commit to every single one of those 12 pledges that are outlined in that manifesto to this community. And what I'd say to you is that I'm from here and for here. This is my home. I care very passionately about Greater Manchester and have been involved in getting us to this point today over the last 3 years. A couple of years ago, I had a choice as the only Conservative leader in Greater Manchester about whether I go and work with Labour councils across this city region to do this. And it would have been very easy for me to say, no, I don't want to do that. But I think we are stronger together when we work across our self-imposed administrative boundaries to get us to this point. I understand the deal inside out. And of course, I think it will be important, and you'd expect me to say this, that I think having a Conservative mayor for Greater Manchester working with a Conservative government would be helpful. But equally, for this mayoralty to be successful in future, you need to have a mayor who can also work with the council leaders of Greater Manchester, because those two things need to happen at the same time. I'm the only candidate here that can say to you genuinely, not only could I do it, but I have done it for the last 3 years to get us to this point today. I'm really confident and ambitious for our future, a shared future together where we can do something very different. And I want you to try and join with me on May the 4th and create history in this city and elect me as Mayor of Greater Manchester. Thank you very much.
Firstly, on your behalf, I'd like to thank the candidates. That was a very well-informed, well-conducted, respectfully conducted debate. Thank you to all of you for remaining respectful. Thank you to all the candidates for, by and large, sticking to time and enabling us to get through a number of issues. Thank you very much. So just before I call on Mark Lee, could I ask you please to express your appreciation for all of the candidates. Anstee very kindly plugged what I'm going to do next, which tonight we are formally launching the Jewish Communities Manifesto for Greater Manchester, jointly put together by the Jewish Representative Council of Greater Manchester and Region and the Jewish Leadership Council. All of the candidates were given the opportunity to see it. I'm going to distribute a printed copy to everybody tonight. Maybe before everybody goes, we could just have a picture taken with it, just to show that you've all received one. The key thing about this is it sets out the issues that this community believes are important for the candidates to take into account. One of these candidates is going to be the Mayor of Greater Manchester on May the 5th, and therefore these are going to be the issues that this community will hold the mayor to account on when it comes to re-election. So I will distribute one of these formally to each of the candidates, and you are also able to pick one up on the way out. Please do so that you can see what are the issues that are important. So just before, I could just ask the candidates to just hold up their manifesto so we can all see it, so formally launched. Thank you very much. And so, to the final word tonight, somebody who's been very instrumental in working with the Rep Council and Nathan Moroder and putting that on together, somebody I'm very proud to call a colleague, our Northwest Regional Manager for the Jewish Leadership Council, Mark Levy.
Thank you. Just some very, very quick thank yous before we conclude the evening. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. O for allowing us to host the event here. I'd also like to thank the Jewish Representative Council, but I'd also like to thank Nathan, who's done more than anyone else. The exams and everything else going on, so we're very, very grateful to Nathan. I'd like to thank Simon for chairing the evening. All of the candidates are taking time out of their busy schedule, not just to meet with us here tonight, but they've also taken time out to meet with me repeatedly over the last few weeks, and they're very, very grateful, and the community is in great hands, irrespective of who gets elected. So thank you very much once again. We just have to mention Stephen Morris there from the English Democrats, and the independent candidate Marcus Farmer, just some housekeeping there in accordance with the election rules. So thank you very much. That concludes the evening.